can't.
Hi.
Hi. What's hi? Can I spend it?
I have a paycheck due this week. And
you're a month late again. Again.
I promise as soon as I...
If promises were crackers, my daughter would be fat.
I'm really sorry, Mr. Dickovich. You know, all I got is this 20 for the rest of the week.
Sorry doesn't pay the rent. And don't try to sneak past me. I have ears like a cat and eyes like a rodent.
Thanks, Mr. Dickovich.
Hi, Pete. Oh!
What makes Spider-Man so damn likable? Well, before his debut in Amazing Fantasy number 15, most comic book heroes were like Superman or Captain America. They were selfless and all-powerful beings who helmed their power for the good of humanity. What made Spider-Man so popular was how radically different Peter Parker was from Clark Kent or Steve Rogers. He's just a nerdy student whose life is almost always falling apart. In an interview with the Chicago Tribune in 1996, the late Stan Lee explained that Peter Parker's the one who's the most like me. Nothing ever turns out 100% okay. He's got a lot of problems, and I can relate to that. In order for a film to understand Peter Parker, it needs to establish tangible consequences for all of his actions. Take, for example, 2018's Spider-Man game for the PlayStation 4. In the opening cinematic, Peter's about to pursue a criminal when he gets an eviction notice. Peter looks at it and makes the decision to leave. But cut to nighttime, and when Peter returns to his apartment, he realizes he's been evicted, and the player is forced to go hunting for his belongings in garbage trucks across the city. Films are almost always stories about people. Spider-Man 2 focuses intensely on the character of Peter Parker and his struggle with sacrifice, and it truly understands that in order for the audience to care about what goes on when he puts on the mask, we have to have empathy for the person underneath it. Spider-Man 2 has a total runtime of 2 hours and 15 minutes, yet Spider-Man is on screen for very little of that runtime. This is because the film is primarily interested in building the hero, Peter Parker, rather than the superhero. The majority of the film is spent displaying Peter's failings at every aspect of his life, eventually even failing at being Spider-Man when he loses his powers. The opening pizza delivery sequence ends with him being hounded by his manager and fired. Peter then gets nearly fired by J. Jonah Jameson and doesn't cover the advance he was given weeks prior. Then Peter's getting pressure from his best friend Harry over the death of his father, helping to establish consequences for his actions in the previous film. He can't help May pay off her mortgage because he can't even pay his own rent. His idols call him lazy. His clothes get stained from his costume. He's failing at his classes. He misses MJ's show and can't even tell her his true feelings. In just the first act alone, the film has already established Peter's crumbling personal life and relationship with MJ. The second act explores how Peter's personal failings are affecting his powers, and it all culminates in the planetarium sequence, where MJ forsakes Peter and gets engaged with Jameson's star astronaut son, and a drunk Harry slaps Peter over his father's death. The next scene shows the direct result of Peter's personal life on his powers, as he falls on a dumpster and eventually he does what no one in the audience expects in a superhero film. Peter Parker gives up at what he's meant to do. And even when he does give up being a superhero, at first everything seems to be going well in his life. But that small glimpse of hope doesn't translate into long-term satisfaction. I think a scene that details this really well is when Peter confesses to Aunt May that he's partly responsible for Uncle Ben's death. It's a heartbreaking scene because May doesn't react with compassion, but rather she pulls back, quite literally removing her hand from Peter's and walking away. An act that continues the theme that our actions have real consequences. All this is necessary for the audience to have that pure feeling of happiness when MJ discovers Peter's true identity in the film's climax. There's nothing like the satisfaction you feel the first time you watch the movie, and it hits me every single time. This is gratification done right. The first film ends with Peter sacrificing his relationship with MJ for being Spider-Man, establishing the theme that runs through the second film. Peter's constantly at odds with MJ, missing her play, lying to her about his true feelings, and ultimately being an empty seat. There's even a scene where he pretends to confess his secret identity to MJ over the phone, and this creates immense empathy for Peter, as we feel his pain affecting his powers and the relationship he has with everyone else in his life. It's through all this setup and all of this sacrifice that the audience is able to have that moment of gratification, and it's what makes Spider-Man 2 a superhero movie unlike any other. Spider-Man 2 is a near-perfect superhero film, capturing the essence of who Peter Parker is as a character and highlighting what makes him so unique in his personal struggles. It's a film about sacrifice and consequences, and I don't know if any Spider-Man film will ever be as good as this one. Spider-Man 2 is a lesson in displaying sacrifice and creating empathy for our protagonist, and a lesson that I think all other superhero films can learn from. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll catch you next one.